Okay, good morning, everyone. My name is Christina Green. As Kelly mentioned earlier, I'm a part of the advisory committee, and I'll be introducing our next speaker. So I'm very excited to introduce the next session that Humanists at Work has put together for everyone today. As a PhD student, candidate going into my seventh year, with no guaranteed funding or employment, I've begun to job search. And so I've begun the job search for positions in the university and also outside of the university, as we've been talking about today. And websites such as Indeed.com and Idealist.org have been helpful, but they do not always provide the best options for me when searching for a position. So I was first introduced to LinkedIn Jobs about a year ago while perusing the website. And through the website, a couple of months ago, I downloaded the job app for smartphones. So not only is LinkedIn great for connecting and building networks, but it's also proven to be really helpful for locating available positions in the fields of interests, or in my fields of interests, and applying to positions through the LinkedIn website as well. So I found the job app to be especially helpful because it allows for the creation of job alerts that get sent to my app and also to my Gmail account. So you're able to search for, you know, search with specific key terms and set up alerts that way in specific regions that you're interested in. So let's say you're interested in living in Chicago, you can set up alerts and they'll send available positions daily. So that's really helpful. So with that said, it's with great pleasure that I introduce our next session speaker, Dr. Ann Dela Cruz. Dr. Dela Cruz is the Director of Diversity, Inclusion, and Admission at the UCLA Graduate Division. She oversees the graduate outreach, recruitment, and admissions for UCLA master's and doctoral programs, as well as graduate diversity efforts. Prior to joining the graduate division, Dr. Dela Cruz was an assistant director at the UCLA Anderson School of Management Professional MBA Program's Career Management Center, where she managed part-time MBA Career Center operations, career coach students, and programmed leadership and professional development offerings for executive and fully employed MBA students. She earned her BA in English and BA in economics from UCLA, an MA in English, and an MA in teaching ESL from California State University, Los Angeles, and a doctorate in education from UCLA's Graduate School of Education and Information Studies. Dr. Dela Cruz also completed the UCLA Anderson School of Management Executive Program in General Management. Needless to say, Dr. Dela Cruz has done exceptional work within academia, and we're all really excited for her presentation today. So please welcome Dr. Ann Dela Cruz.
Thank you, Christina. Good morning, everyone. How is everyone doing today? Great. I love this energy. So this morning, we are going to talk about LinkedIn. And just for kicks, how many of you have actually gone into LinkedIn and played around with LinkedIn? Show of hands. All right. So when we have our conversation today, it's going to be something that is familiar. And by the time you leave, it's going to be something that's going to be a tool for you to use. And I hope that today's session is going to be something that you'll walk away from and think, wow, I didn't think about that, but I'm going to really think about this across my whole career. So what we're going to do is we're going to just ask you a couple questions. I want to keep it informal and interactive. I'm going to have some polls throughout the course of today just to keep everybody awake. There's also going to be a section where I'm going to have you actually work on your summary statement. This is not one of those sessions where I'm going to talk to you a lot. I'm going to give you a foundation and the baseline for certain things, but this is your time to actually work on your LinkedIn profile. So on your tables, you will see some worksheets that we will get to. So if you want to just have that in front of you and take a look at it when we get to the working session, that's going to be something that we will utilize for today. But in terms of me getting a sense of who you are, it would be really helpful for me to understand where you are in your career development process. So by show of hands, how many of you would consider yourselves exploring various careers? And you can be in multiple stages of this. Okay, we have a lot of explorers. Awesome. So for those of you who are currently in a position or in a field that you would like to continue in, how many of you would consider yourself enhancers? Okay, great. We have a couple hands. And then for those of you who are interested in looking at change, making a change in industry or function, how many of you are interested in that? Wonderful. So an enhancer is someone who is essentially maybe in a particular field or industry. They might want to move up a particular career path, but it's essentially a set path. Whereas, say, if you were a switcher, you might be looking at a different industry or a different function. So really, there's opportunity for you to be in all these different phases during your job search, and it very much happens on a regular basis, where you might be doing a change, but then it just happenstance you might be enhancing. So what I'd like to do today is just give you an overview of what we're going to do. Essentially, we're going to give you a brief overview of the networking component. You've already had conversations this morning, but we're really going to tie in how the social media piece fits in. And then we're going to really delve into LinkedIn because it is the ultimate professional social media tool that you can use in your job search. What I'd like to integrate into that conversation today is really how you are going to strategically use LinkedIn. I think there is this sense that LinkedIn is available to everybody and you can essentially put in a profile. But for you to have an effective job search, you have to take an active role in that job search. And what that involves is being very strategic about what you decide to put out there. So we're gonna talk about that. And then I'm just gonna give you a brief overview on Web 2.0 tools. And then really, this is your time to work on your summary statements. That is gonna be our end goal. So by the time you walk out, you will have the framework and the basis for your summary statement. So with that being said, many of you have probably seen the assignment that we gave. So how many of you actually looked at this? You didn't necessarily have to do it, but okay, many of you looked at that. And the goal for this is to start getting you really familiar with the tool, because essentially the tool is going to equip you not only with job search tools, but it will help you approach branding yourself in a different way. So whether you are enhancing or whether you are changing careers, or even if you're exploring careers, the goal of LinkedIn is for you to utilize that as one of your many branding tools to really set yourself apart from other people. Now, I know commonly when people talk about branding or positioning, it sounds very corporate, but it's really something that you want to think about in terms of becoming part of some type of community. You want to enter a particular discourse community, especially for those of us in the arts, humanities, social sciences. We do want to be part of that group, but we also want to set ourselves apart from others so that we can communicate the value that we bring to an employer, to an organization. So that's something that we'd like to talk about today. So just out of curiosity, when we see people, does anybody want to take a guess how long it takes to make an impression on somebody when you see somebody? 3 seconds, 7 seconds, any 5 seconds. So according to a couple studies, it takes about 7 seconds, right? You see somebody, you form an impression. But really with social media, things happen at a faster rate. You think about Twitter, for example, and you only have so many characters you have to use. You're literally forming that impression very quickly. So what I want you to think about is really what is the type of impression that you will want to leave with people. And part of that today that I hope you will take away is it is all about you telling your story. And anything comes down to you being able to know yourself so that you can communicate the skill set that you have. We're going to talk a lot about transferable skills. So regardless of what type of position you're looking at or industry, this is really the core of doing that job search. So when we're talking about networking, which I was very pleased to see many of you engaging in before this particular session, you really want to look at networking from the perspective of relationship building. And when you're talking to people, you're essentially putting out there the value that you bring, and you're also looking at connecting with people. So what is the mutual benefit potentially you can have with that connection? So I want you to rethink about networking, not as a scary thing that people tend to have, but it's more of this reciprocal knowledge sharing. And I think if you reframe it from that perspective, it's not as scary. So in terms of networking, we all know the benefits. We've heard about it from other people. And I think really for job search, you're going to utilize LinkedIn and some of these tools from a data gathering perspective, but also from a perspective of widening your network. So it's really something that we're going to talk about, and how you do that is going to be a multi-pronged approach. You're going to sell yourself, you're going to meet people, and you're going to target. And really, we want you to be strategic about the process. So when you are doing any type of networking, whether it's face-to-face or whether you are actually going to utilize a social network, you really want to be very thoughtful about it. So the first thing that you have to do is you need to identify some kind of goal or objective. So when you're going to a conference, when you're writing that LinkedIn profile, you want to have some kind of strategy for what you want to accomplish. Because when you're looking at metrics, this is going to be something that'll be a little helpful. Then you want to think about the outcomes based on your work. What is it that you would like to get out of that actual exchange? So I'll give you an example. When I go to a conference, I try to meet at least 3 people that I have never met before. And my goal is for each person that I meet, I try to ask if they could pretty much give me 1 to 2 people who might actually align with my research interests. So just in that particular goal, I'm able to expand my network and help identify that. So that kind of is an example of that. And then at the end of the day, you want to actually implement it. So you want to put together a communication plan that involves follow-up. So when you talk to people or connect with people, then there is going to be effort in terms of following up. And this is absolutely the case when you connect with somebody on LinkedIn. So what does a communication plan look like? There are certain elements of a communication plan that you want to think about. So the first part, obviously, is the planning piece. You're going to put together some kind of framework so you have particular goals. Now, you don't go into anything without doing some level of research or getting to know what that industry is like or that function or who are the key players. So that's going to be the level of work, pre-work that you will do. The implementation is actually what your plan is going to be, and then you're going to measure and evaluate. You might find that some of the approaches that you're utilizing are not as effective, so you tweak it. It's totally fine. And we're going to talk about this when we talk about LinkedIn and keywords. You might think that you're hitting on certain keywords that really are not giving you that return when you're utilizing it. So it's going to be an iterative process. Now, if we're going to take this model and take a look at the elements of a story, there are certain things we think about when we think about a story. We think about characters, we think about plots, we think about, you know, even the narrative and the point of view. But really, there are certain things that matter when you're writing your LinkedIn profile. The first is really, who is the character? And the character in this case is you. So your job is to make the story such that people are going to want to be intrigued by you, that they are going to want to connect with you. And that's really something that you can only do if you know yourself. So within career development, we have a concept called self-assessment. So that's where you evaluate your values, you evaluate your skill set, you evaluate maybe the gaps that you have in your skill set so that you can achieve that particular career goal. So those are the things that you would think about. The other thing is really thinking about what is the need. So I have number two, does somebody want something badly enough? So if you are targeting a particular company or an organization, what is their pain point? What is it that they need help with? And that is the frame of what you are going to perhaps think about building your LinkedIn profile with. Now, essentially, you don't have to always have a challenge or, you know, thing that you have to feel like you have to overcome, but you do want to connect the dots. And I think there's something compelling about that story where somebody overcomes something or achieves something great that you really are drawn to that character. So we're going to talk about what plot might look like in the form of a LinkedIn profile. And then finally, you want to highlight your accomplishments. So just out of curiosity, how many of you are really comfortable talking about yourself? Like if I had to ask you, do you feel comfortable? There's not a lot of hands, right? So this is the one thing about job search that you have to really learn to do better. And I think it's hard for us because we are all taught to be very humble. But I want you to rethink about it in a different frame. You need to talk about your key accomplishments in order for people to see the value and the contributions you can bring to an organization. So for you to do that, that's going to be something that we will explore in terms of how to do that. But really, I think that's a mind shift that all of us have to work on. So if you were to look at branding, I used to be a marketing manager in a past life. So if you are the product and the service, and you are trying to put yourself out there, there's different concepts of the marketing P's that we look at. So you'll want to know you as the product, who you are, and what you're gonna say, what is the value proposition that we always talk about. Place, that ties into research and targeting. What are the industries or functions that you're exploring that you would like to enter? And knowing that is helpful. The packaging piece is all-inclusive. So we're just talking about LinkedIn today, but the LinkedIn profile has to match what is part of your overall marketing package, whether it's your resume, your CV, your elevator pitch, all of that should come together. And then you have promotion, price, and really, that's really how you get yourself out there and knowing your worth. And then finally, you have to put together a plan. The LinkedIn piece is so great because you get to tell your story, you get to create it. And if the story doesn't work, then you get to rewrite that story. So that is the best part about LinkedIn, you get to write it. So I really want you to think about this from a very exciting, creative perspective as well. So when you're thinking about personal branding, there are three things that you want to think about. The first piece is what you have to offer. So what are the skills you bring? What is the knowledge that you have? What are some of the things that you can contribute to an organization? You also want to think about what the marketplace offers. So we're looking for matches at this point. So what is the marketplace looking for? What are they looking for in particular, you know, in terms of skill sets? And if you don't have that skill set, what do you need to do to get that skill set? And then finally, you're looking at needs. At the end of the day, we are writing our LinkedIn profiles for some goal. And the goal is for you to identify that. So whether you are seeking to network with people or looking for a job or both, you know, really you want to be very clear about what that is. In an ideal situation, you get your VP or your value proposition. And that is how you can differentiate yourself from other people who are also applying to positions and others who are also seeking similar opportunities. So in terms of networking, I'll just give you some stats. So there's only 30% of people who love to network. So, you know, we want to make sure that this is something that you take advantage of because this is a key strength. If you can really develop this. The other thing to consider is there's an increasing number of people using social media. And I think that's something where this time is an opportunity for you to capitalize on that. So we really want you to do that. So really, at the end of the day, we want you to think about all of your networking, online and in person. They complement one another, but for purposes of today, we will talk about the online piece. So the key thing about social media is it is always on. 24/7. We are not on 24/7, but our LinkedIn profiles are. So regardless of where you are in the world, who you meet, this is your opportunity to really shine and to share your accomplishments. And it's really our way of becoming part of a virtual community. There's something to be said about social networking, and part of that is becoming a part of some group or social community. So there's all these social networks that you can select. I actually like to say that LinkedIn is probably the best one to start out with. So when I talk to a lot of people, it's a good one to start out with because it really is highlighting you as a person, as a professional, as a person who is really defining the career path that you want to take. You can use certainly other social networks, but really the LinkedIn piece is the professional piece to start looking at. So if I were to create a hierarchy, I would say LinkedIn is great, but you can also integrate other types of social media. So if you are looking to use LinkedIn as a professional profile, you can say utilize a Twitter, Google, or YouTube account to link to your LinkedIn account, or you can even integrate some of the blogs as part of your LinkedIn. So don't feel like it has to be a standalone. You can be as creative as you want when you're creating your LinkedIn profile. You can actually utilize some of these other social network tools as content that you will use in your LinkedIn profile. So in terms of social networking, there's two roles we all take when we engage in any of these tools. The first role is somebody who's a data consumer. That's when we're gathering data. It's kind of passive. We're just scoping, looking at what's out there. But the second piece is what I want you to think about becoming, which is the data contributor. You know, you really want to take an active role. You want to start sharing knowledge and also really being able to talk about your accomplishments so that there is a match that happens later on. You know, a combination of these are really important when you're constantly updating your profile, but really I think we're moving towards the data contributor side of things. So in terms of LinkedIn, this is your opportunity to brand yourself. This is where you tell your story and connect the dots for people. So the way they talk about LinkedIn is it's a research tool, it's a connecting tool, but at the end of the day, it is a branding tool for you to utilize. And that's what we're gonna talk about today. So when you're promoting yourself with LinkedIn, there are a couple things you wanna think about. So the first part is targeting the audience. When somebody goes into LinkedIn, who is it that you want to target? Are you targeting particular hiring managers? Are you targeting search firms? Are you targeting other colleagues? Are you targeting maybe other faculty members? It's something to think about because the way you write your profile is going to be different based on that. The other thing to consider is highlighting valuable skill sets and knowledge. So based on what your goal is, you may select certain skill sets that really highlight that particular objective. You can have tons of skills and tons of things that you know, but you really want to make sure that you are getting to the skill sets that you're targeting specifically. And then finally, there's this progression of telling the story. And this is where you're gonna combine your education and the experience to really connect the dots for people. So, you know, essentially you're going to talk about your evolution in terms of where you were, where you are today, and where you wanna go, right? It's the basic piece of the plot. It's the beginning, middle, and the end. So this is where you're gonna utilize this framework to create that LinkedIn profile. So there's all these really interesting constraints on what you can do in the LinkedIn profile. And the key thing that I want to share with you today is really utilizing number 3, which is the summary section. That's where we're gonna have our working session. So you get 2,000 characters to talk about you. That's like the most that you would get in any section. But it's so robust because when people are doing searches, that is essentially what can populate those searches. So that's why we're focusing on that today. So quick poll. When you put together your LinkedIn profile initially, how many of you had your resume or CV in front of you while you were doing it? Okay, couple hands, great. So when you were putting your profile, how many of you had examples of some LinkedIn profiles that you thought were pretty good? Okay, couple hands. And then when you were also doing it, how many of you had job descriptions of positions that you were targeting when you were putting your LinkedIn profile? So fewer hands. So as you're hearing, we're really thinking about getting to know the people who are searching. And I think part of it is really being able to identify not only what is the target, but what is the set of keywords that you are going to want to build and integrate into your LinkedIn profile, and what is it that people will consider when they look at it. So I actually am very pleased to share Kelly. She gave me permission to utilize her profile. So we are going to go through some of the components very briefly. So essentially, when you're looking at a LinkedIn profile, it's first impressions, right? So you definitely want a recent photo so when people see you, they can know you. And I know that there is a photo booth, so no selfies. You want to have a professional-looking photo, so we encourage you to do that. You also, to begin with, just should see where you fall in the Google world. So I would say if you haven't already done it, Google yourself and see who are your Google gangers. So there's always people who have similar names, right? And you're wondering, man, who are the other Ann Dela Cruzes and what do they do? So find out who your Google gangers are. The other thing to look at when you search for yourself is see where you are on the results page of Google. So if you actually write a good LinkedIn profile, you know, you will actually come up on one of the top results on Google. And that is one of the metrics that can be used. And that's when you know you're effectively utilizing the keywords and using search engine optimization. So that is something to consider. And then finally, your profile headline. That's something people see when they do their searches. So when they're looking at people, they're pretty much seeing this key descriptor. So this really depends on your goal for writing that LinkedIn profile. So do you want to network? Are you looking for a job? Do you want to set yourself as that expert? So those are things that you'd like to include in there. And in Kelly's case, it's really helpful that we know who she is and the institution she works for, the organization, so that we can make that connection with her. So everything has a purpose, everything has a reason. So the other component is the experience piece. So how many of you found this particular section easy to do? Listing it out. Okay, the listing part is the easy part. So what I want you to think about is not just listing the accomplishments, but really thinking about what aspects of these experiences would really highlight you. So your skills, your work with particular areas, or even populations that you work with, or things that you really feel would be helpful to prospective people viewing your profile. So it's great to have your title and the organization you work for, but maybe you might want to explore adding a little bit more. You have space, so this is where you can help connect the dots. Skills, so this is something that LinkedIn relatively added within the last few years, and it's great because it shows other people who notify other LinkedIn users about your particular skill sets. So one thing that happens is it generally pops up. Now, I would say that it's always great to look at this, and more people are utilizing this, but I want you to really think about looking at what are the top skills that people are assigning to you and building that into your LinkedIn profile, because that might be a strength that you might not necessarily know about that you need to include. So keep looking at this, because this can help as you over time revisit and rewrite your LinkedIn profile. And then the education piece. So the education piece is really key. And for all of you who are pursuing graduate programs, you are engaging in such great work, and you are bringing new knowledge. So the key question is, how are you going to talk about that and link it to your education? So you have the opportunity to not only list your degree and your institution, but you can have a blurb about what you did and what you found. And it doesn't have to be long, but it might help people get a context for just where you were and where you are. You know, when we talk about plot, beginning, middle, and end, if you're talking about undergrad and grad, that's a really great way of connecting the dots for people. So maybe adding one or two sentences about what you learned, maybe if you did a thesis, if you did a dissertation, if you did a, you know, some other kind of project, that might help connect the dots for folks. And then groups. So sometimes people don't really look at this, but it's actually pretty robust. So if there are groups that are on LinkedIn, you'll definitely want to add them, but be strategic. You don't want to be adding groups that you're not interested in because it does take away from the limit of groups. However, what's nice about groups is if you want to meet people in that group, even if you're not connected, because you're a member of a group, you can actually see all the members of that group. And that's a really great way for you to connect within that particular sphere or community. So be very strategic about the groups that you pick. And also, picking the groups adds to the way you brand yourself. So the, you know, you always hear, you know, you are who your friends are, you are who your groups that you pick are. Right? So think about what that looks like. And then at the end of the day, you'll want to just think about who you want to follow as well, because that also says something about your interests or where you would like to maybe have conversations with other folks about. So essentially, you know, that's really the baseline of what a LinkedIn profile looks like. So I'm going to actually go through another profile of a friend of mine who has built out his LinkedIn profile. So his name is Jason Alba. Jason Alba is actually considered one of the LinkedIn experts. He wrote the book, Who's on LinkedIn or What's on LinkedIn and Now What? So essentially, he went through the process I just talked to you about. He has a story, and his story is that he was a tech guy who worked and was laid off, and he had to figure out what to do next. That was his story. So essentially, what he did was he put together a website to help people utilize LinkedIn to find jobs, right? So some of the key things that he did in his particular profile covers the whole contact piece. So when you're putting together your LinkedIn profile, you have to decide what is the level of engagement and contact you want with people. Do you just want to have your profile so people read about you, or do you really want to connect with people? If that is the case, then you can essentially add contact information. And that is whatever you feel comfortable with, whether it's an email, whether you just want to take people through InMail. You really want to think about how much connections do you want with people. And then really, you want to utilize other media. So, you know, we talk about things like the digital humanities, where we're taking multiple media and really trying to build a portfolio of different things. So again, like that, you want to think about LinkedIn. Not only are you writing content, but what are some of the portfolio pieces that you've worked on that you want to include in your LinkedIn profile? It makes it a little bit more engaging. You know, we have a tendency to want to have this visual of, you know, different things on a page. So this might be a way for you to utilize that. And then as you could see, there's a summary section. And it's a really big section. It's 2,000 characters. So this is why we're going to have you focus on this today. So in terms of the summary statements, this is essentially your way of telling people about you. So you're going to introduce yourself. You're going to highlight key accomplishments. You're going to actually also talk to people about how they can connect with you. But at the end of the day, the summary statement should have some kind of a value proposition or a next step or an ask. You know, sometimes when you meet people and they have an elevator pitch, they tell you who you are, where they came from, their research, but then it ends there. And you're waiting for that punchline, right? You're waiting for that ask of like, do you know somebody or can we connect? And they don't get there. So what I want you to think about is what is going to be your next step or your ask when you put this together on your LinkedIn profile. Whether it's to connect with somebody, whether you're exploring opportunities or doing informational interviews, I really want you to be very strategic about that. So that's something that we're going to do. And then essentially, just some key things as we're going to go into the activities, I want you to think about keywords. So for the particular industries or functions that you're interested in, what are those words people like? What are the buzzwords? And this is where we're now creating the stories. And this is where you want to build those into what you're going to write. So let's jump into our activity. So essentially, everybody has this worksheet in front of you. And the worksheet is really nice because it'll actually have you think about some of the things that we talked about earlier. So essentially, you're going to talk about where you are in your career. You're going to identify who are the people that you're going to consider when you're writing in your LinkedIn profile. There's a question of industry. So you can definitely be as open, as wide as you'd like. Now, at the end of the day, to make it easier for you for the purpose of this exercise, I would suggest you pick maybe one industry to focus on for now, but then you can always do this process for various industries. So let's say you're interested in academia and then you're also looking at consulting. You know, you can do this particular process in two different times. But for today, pick one so that you can focus on that. And then you're going to go to the back of the page, and this is where you're going to start building some components of your summary. So it's pretty much some high-level information about you. I'm going to ask that you think of three accomplishment statements that really talk about who you are and the skill sets that you want to impart to those who see your LinkedIn profiles. And then really looking at what are the other things that you can incorporate. So, you know, we looked at some of the blogs people were pointing to. Are there other digital portfolio pieces that you want to incorporate or are thinking to incorporate in the future? And then finally, it asks you questions about who you want to connect with, how you want to connect with them, and then really doing the value proposition piece. So for the purposes of today, I'm going to look at Sarah because Sarah is going to be our timekeeper. Essentially, we're going to give you 10 minutes to work on this worksheet, but if you finish sooner, look up, let us know, and then we can go on to the next piece. And the next piece is going to be really interactive because we're going to have you pair up, and then you are actually going to share what you came up with, get some friendly feedback, and then you're going to swap. So this is our work time. So any questions about the activity before we jump into the activity? Okay, I think we're all ready to jump in. So Sarah will start the time. You have about 10 minutes to start working on your worksheet. All right, everyone. So that concludes our 10-minute work. So what I'd like for everybody to do at this point is for you to find somebody who is sitting next to you. You're going to work in pairs. If there is an odd number of people, you could either try to find somebody at another table who is seeking someone to work with, or you can work in a group of three, but work in the group of three only after you have tried to find one other person, because that's going to be optimal for this particular session. So if you have identified and made eye contact with somebody, we're going to start with the first round. You're going to have 5 minutes, and essentially what I'd like to ask you all to do is to pretty much share with your partner what you put on paper, and then also get some feedback from that person. So we'll start now. All right, everyone, let's start to regroup. I know that there's a lot of exciting conversation and synergy that is happening, and this is exactly what we want to make sure we continue. So one of the things in doing this, as with any other components of your marketing package, when you're putting together the materials for your job search, is you want to find somebody that you can work with to talk through those pieces, to get feedback. Oftentimes, you know, we always are very focused on putting some of the materials together that we miss certain things. And I think this particular experience that we just experienced really gives you a sense for the value of that feedback that you can get. The one thing that I would also encourage you to do as you're putting together your LinkedIn profile, after you write it, talk to people who know you, whether it's your advisors, those your colleagues, your peers, because I think it's, again, something where we are taught to be very humble, and we forget to include key accomplishments. And in the case where you're having those conversations with other people, they will actually flag those for you. So, you know, please keep this in mind and continue to do this. So just out of curiosity, show of hands, how many of you found this particular exercise easy? It's not easy, right? How many of you found it harder than you thought it would be? And that's typically the case. So this really goes to show you that there is work to be done, and it is a constant iterative process. And I hope this really gets you to start thinking about your LinkedIn profile from a perspective of really targeting. You know, we think about when we watch TV, we see all these ads. We want you to be very, very thoughtful, and you want to be like those advertisers who are appealing to a particular group, except you are going to utilize that same strategy to connect with people based on what your goal or objective is for LinkedIn. So we're going to keep moving on, and what I'll do is I'll zip through the rest of the presentation, and then we'll open it up for Q&A. So we've gone past the summary statement. We're, again, looking at the experience, just a couple tips on this. So when you are putting together your experience, you might want to add a couple bullet points. I would probably say the same rules apply when you are writing a resume or a CV. You want it to be very clean, you want it to be very crisp. You don't want really long bullets unless you are writing a narrative or a paragraph. So really be cognizant about that, and that's where you really want to get somebody's feedback in terms of the way it looks. There was a really great question earlier as I was walking around about putting some of the portfolio pieces and pictures on your LinkedIn profile. Should you put it on top? Should you put it on the bottom? And I would say play with it. You know, what you don't want to do is you don't want to upload photos or other pieces that take up a very large part of the real estate. So think about it from the perspective of you pulling up your LinkedIn profile. You want to make sure that the key components of who you are shown on the top. You don't want people scrolling to the bottom of your LinkedIn profile to find the good stuff. You want that to be really highlighted on top. But again, you know, if you have the portfolio pieces, you know, there are certain areas where you can maybe incorporate it either in the middle or within your different experiences. What's nice about LinkedIn is now you can actually upload either web pages or files. In the past, you had to embed it into the HTML, but they have made it easier. So you can certainly do that now as well. The other thing to consider is with your images, just be careful with the size of the images. Again, you'll probably want to scale it so that it's not blowing up your LinkedIn profile, that it's really leading people to scroll. Most people don't want to scroll for more than 3 or 4 swipes. And you think about the use of mobile devices, so you really want to make sure that the content is clear, concise, but still sharing what you would like to share on your profile. And then publications. So, you know, whether you're working on publications, conference presentations, this is where you really get to highlight those pieces. Don't forget to include that in your LinkedIn profile. I think what's great about including those pieces is as you're getting ready to network with people, they want to see that. So make sure that you provide them with an overview of all the different experiences and interactions you have with folks in your discourse community. Again, in terms of your skills, there have been people who have been very strategic and have asked other colleagues to provide additional skills. Now, I don't have a preference either way. If you feel like there is a particular skill set that you really want to get numbers up for, you can certainly talk to your colleagues and say, you know, if these particular skills come up and they ask you to rate me, I would really appreciate it if you can go ahead and, you know, enter that information. More of the search firms are starting to look at this from just a keyword perspective, so don't feel like you have to have high numbers, but use this as a mechanism to potentially incorporate that into the actual content you're writing. And then in terms of the education piece, you can certainly add maybe 1 or 2 lines to add a little bit of extra narrative to each particular experience. What's nice is you can actually incorporate recommendations from people. So let's say in this particular case, you might have received a degree from an institution, you have your summary, but then you've worked with either peers or faculty or colleagues. You can essentially get them to write a recommendation to talk about how they engaged with you. So if you're thinking about job search, there are certain skill sets that employers are looking for. They're looking at individual contributors. They're looking for people who could work in groups. They're looking for people who have leadership skills. And they're looking for people who are problem solvers. So in terms of that context, it might be nice for you, if you can, to identify people who might be willing to write something about some of those skills. And if they can tie it to either the education aspect or the experience, that would give another lens into who you are. So that's another way to utilize the recommendations. Oftentimes, people will also utilize the interest side. So I would say, from a search engine optimization perspective, you may want to think about what are some of the keywords and incorporate that into the interest page or in the interest section. I think that will also help you move up in the search results as you're entering that information. And then also, what's kind of nice is you get to see who are the other people that are being looked at when they look at your profile. So check this out every so often, because you might see some kind of path if you look at this periodically. So I was looking at mine the other day, and I noticed that there was a trend of people who were interested in things relating to emotional intelligence, since that was one of the things that I was really excited about. I literally picked all these groups, and then all of a sudden I started seeing other people that I might want to connect with who have that shared interest. So check that section out, because they might actually identify folks that you might want to connect with. And then also look at your connections and look at connections of other people that you are connected to. You might not necessarily think about connecting with somebody in your own connections list, but if you're looking at other folks that you meet, then that's really where you can utilize that robust network. So really think about who you want to meet, which groups you want to be a part of, and then the influencers that you want to follow, because that will be part of your LinkedIn profile. So essentially what we are also going to talk about is just very briefly some of the best practices. So we already talked about the professional photo. It's really important that you keep that up to date. When people meet you, they expect to see that you are the person on your profile. I know that with certain dating sites, there's always a mismatch, right? We've experienced that, we've heard stories. So we want to make sure that that is accurate. We also want to have a professional headline that meets your objective. So whether you are meeting people to connect, looking for a job, exploring opportunities, make sure that that is on there. And then the key piece is just your accomplishments. Be strategic about what you would like to cover in those accomplishments. And then keep your information updated. The one thing that I have to say, and it's true for resumes and CVs, don't wait until the last minute to update anything, resumes, CVs, LinkedIn, because you have to do it while it's still fresh. Otherwise, you're gonna miss something that's so key. So I say this for your LinkedIn profile. As you're in the process, write that section and add it in there. You can always add later, but do it while it's fresh. And then again, get feedback from others. Utilize that peer support network. So the other thing that I want to share, I know we spent a lot of time on the LinkedIn profile, is I want to talk about some of the other aspects of the LinkedIn capabilities. And I know that Christina talked about the app. So I'm going to zip through some of these portions in terms of search. So we talked about you actually publishing about you, but I want to touch upon LinkedIn as a research tool. So you might want to, say, learn about companies or learn about industries. And LinkedIn allows you to do this if you do certain searches. So in the particular case of a company, you might just want to start out with a general search. You can search company, industry, function. In this case, I was just curious, so I said, what's at Google? What are some opportunities? And what I found was there were certain positions that are posted. So oftentimes, corporate human resources will utilize this, as well as search firms, to post positions that are open. So this is, again, something, if you haven't explored, I would suggest that you do it. You can set alerts so it tells you the type of positions that are opening. You definitely want to start looking at a general search, and then you can hone in on more particular searches. So in this case, I was looking to see what would pop up for Google, and it looks like there's a couple type of tech and business-related positions that I might be interested in. What was also interesting is I saw a bunch of different folks who popped up who are affiliated with Google. So I was just curious to see what their career paths look like. So that's another way for you to see who are the type of individuals that they hire at an organization that you might be targeting. The other thing to consider is also taking a look at what are some of the things that the institution's posting. So we talked about some of the portfolio pieces that you can integrate into your own profile. You might want to see what the institution's posting. In some cases, they're posting things relating to strategies that they're going towards, issues that they're running into. And those are key things that you may want to incorporate as you're building your LinkedIn profile. So really do check out those particular sections as well. And then you can certainly narrow your focus. So if, let's say, I wanted to just focus on a particular section within Google, I just wanted to see the Google groups, I could do that. But really start broad so that you are doing that particular search, and then you can see all the various aspects of the institution. or the organization that you're looking at. Really, the other thing to consider is really getting to know the culture, right? So we talked about match and fit. What do you have to offer? What are the needs of the organization you're trying to target? So this is a really great way. So if you go to a lot of the company pages, that will give you a sense for who they are. And what's nice is they'll actually incorporate a lot of their other social media feeds into their LinkedIn profile. So if they're posting stuff on Twitter or Instagram, it might pop up here. So that's a nice way to do it. And also check out the career section. It'll give you a sense for recently posted positions. Now, I do caution everybody, this is one of the passive job search pieces. So any type of job posting piece is what I would consider passive. I like to talk about really a holistic approach to job search. So you'll want to look at this, but you'll want to start identifying connections so that you can maybe talk to people, meet with people, build that relationship into the company. So use that for this. And then in terms of really just looking at jobs, keep it broad. I know that many of you are looking at exploring different industries and functions, and I say that's a really great thing to do. The other component to think about is start asking other people, what are other industries or functions that you're interested in and doing this general search on LinkedIn? So one of the things that I like to always talk about too is utilizing other resources that you have and then going back into LinkedIn to look for people. So one approach that I like to have people think about is utilizing alumni databases or other databases available at your institution. If you do certain searches, you might return people, and then you can go back into LinkedIn and see what their career path looked like, what their education looked like, what are the organizations they were part of, what were the conferences that they go to. Essentially, that is the information you need in order to connect with them. You can also use the people search in order to get a sense for who are the other people that are like them at like institutions. So let's say you're interested in meeting people who do a certain function. You will see the same type of person at different types of institutions or different types of organizations. And I think that's really something where it can help broaden your search that you're looking at. And then the key thing is to conduct informational interviews. Using LinkedIn to connect with people is a great start, but it is not the end all be all. You really have to reach out to people and follow up. Now, the one thing that we suggest is that you look at some keywords of people that have profiles that intrigue you, and you might want to figure out how that might fit into your own profile. So think about what that might look like. And then also, you might want to look at the honors and awards because many of you might be part of the same circles. This is going to be the way that you're going to connect with people. So if you are going to send an email and meet them, you can maybe talk about a shared honor or group that you are with. It's all about making those connections. And then the other component is really looking at who other people know. So I am picking on one of our associate deans who I work with, Carlos Grijalva, who is a behavioral neuroscientist, but he knows pretty much everybody. So if we were to look at his profile, you know, he is in the sciences, but he knows a lot of people in different industries. So it's always nice to see who he has in his friends list so that I can ask Carlos to introduce me to his friends. So it's that 6 degrees of separation. So I suggest that you look at people who have very wide networks and connections, see who of those folks you would like to connect with, and ask them to introduce you. There's something to be said about these warm introductions that you can get compared to you doing a cold introduction. So definitely utilize that as well. And then essentially think about being very careful about what you put in your profile. So some people like using acronyms and they're great, you just have to spell them out. Sometimes they mean nothing to certain people. So just make sure that you spell them out if you're gonna use it. And this is for the purposes of HR representatives who may not necessarily know what those acronyms mean. You might get a certification and it might be widely well known amongst the people who are in that circle, but for the generalist, it might not be very clear. So definitely make sure that that is something that's worth noting. So essentially, think about not only what you're gonna put out there, but how you're gonna connect with people. Most people will try to connect through in-mail connections. That's the tool within LinkedIn where they can send you mail in there. If that's the path that you choose, that means you have to essentially set the notifications so that it sends you an email. Otherwise, if you don't check it, you won't know. So oftentimes, you might be seeing certain things come through. We've seen that a lot of search firms and a lot of HR folks are starting to use InMail to send people opportunities. And if you're not checking those, then you might miss out on that particular piece. So really think about that. When you meet somebody at, say, a conference or at an event, and you want to connect with them on LinkedIn, don't use the generic, "Can I connect with you?" Because I think everybody does that. You want to stand out. So essentially, if you do that, you get this generic, like, "I'd like to connect with you on LinkedIn." Give them context. So, "Dear Anne, it was a pleasure meeting you at the Humanist at Work workshop in LA. I really enjoyed our conversation about X. Would love to connect with you on LinkedIn. Perhaps we can set up some time to chat over coffee." That's more memorable than this thing. So really, I want you to focus on making that a connecting experience, making it personalized. As you're hearing, you're really going to have to personalize everything, not just your resume CV, but your LinkedIn profile. And then at the end, you know, really think about and be strategic about what you want to put on there. You might have a lot of resources that you want to put on there, but it might not be all relevant based on what your goal is for your profile. So I want you to pick and choose. It's good to inventory everything out first, but make sure that whatever you put on there is going to matter. And then finally, group discussions. How many of you participate in group discussions? Okay, a few of you. So if you want to meet other people with like interests, check out the group discussions and participate in those group discussions. That's a really nice way to start those conversations. So at the end of the day, you really want to think about what is the rich content that you want to add. Accomplishments, we really want you to encourage you to think about what those are. I'm not going to go through this particular piece. I know we'll share the PowerPoint with everybody, but we want you to think about key accomplishments, and we want you to tell that story. And at the end of the day, the question is, who cares? So when you're thinking about your accomplishments, you want to think about what is the impact, what you did, and how that might be relevant to those who see it. So you're thinking, wow, LinkedIn is a lot. I would say start out with LinkedIn before you start trying to incorporate other social media tools into your LinkedIn profile. Just focus on the LinkedIn side. And then you can incorporate all the other tools. Like blogs, but just start out on your profile. I know it can be very overwhelming as well. And then at the end of the day, you also want to think about just how everything fits together. Your resume, your CV, your cover letter, your positioning statement, the LinkedIn profile is just one piece to the puzzle. So, you know, there's a lot of things that we talked about today, and hopefully it all comes full circle where you are utilizing LinkedIn to help you get a sense for what your next step is. And you're going to use it all throughout the job search process. Doesn't matter where you are. You're going to utilize LinkedIn from a research perspective, but also on a communication side. So the one thing that I will leave you with before we open up for Q&A is there's three steps for career switching, and it's also for exploration. There is a faculty member at INSEAD named Herminia Ibarra, and she talks about career switching. So the first thing she talks about is experimenting and taking action. You can utilize LinkedIn to do your research and see what people do. Then you want to create your network. Who's part of that network? Who's part of that community? And then finally, build your story. This is where you're going to take what you have and then really show how you can be part of this network. So with that being said, I think we are ready to go to Q&A. I believe there is a mic that might be available for questions. So if you have a question, we'll just bring a mic to you. And then if you could share your name and your institution, that would be awesome. Is it on? Okay.
Testing?
Okay. Yes.
Is it on now? Oh. Hi. Thank you so much. My name is Roberta Wilson, and I'm at UC Santa Barbara in the English department. So I have so many questions, but I think I'll just start with one. I noticed on one of the profiles that showed up, I think the woman's name was Valerie Kolber, that she had two different titles.
Yeah.
She was the professor at Diablo Valley College, and then also some sort of business professional, right? So my question is, what are your thoughts about presenting oneself along two different, seemingly divergent career paths, right, and having that be even represented in the title?
Sure.
And is that a good strategy? Is that something that is common or feasible? Anyways, you can continue.
Great, thank you for your question. So the question is whether you should actually target a particular position or you can share both. And I think it really just depends on your objective. In her case, she's pretty much established in her career path, so she's saying these are the two type of roles that I'm taking. Now, what I would say is you need to be very careful, though, if you're gonna go that path, if you are trying to target one particular aspect, because it can get confusing. In her case, she's pretty established in her career path. But what I would say is you might wanna actually try something a little different, where you might focus one profile on a particular path. So let's say if the professoriate or the academic route is something that you'd like to try, put it out there for a little bit. See what you get in terms of a response. Let's say, you know, maybe 3 months later, you might want to play with another format, then play with an alternate format. I think that unless you are pretty comfortable with having the two paths, it can get confusing for the audience that you're appealing to. So that's my take on that as well. And then what's nice too, if you decide to switch it up, is that every time you add new content, the search engines will actually pull that data, so it might actually move you up. So if you're thinking about multiple industries or functions, just to make sure that you're constantly moving up in the results, you might actually want to play with that or even change up your profile just a little bit so you keep moving up. Other questions?
Hi, my name is Rita, I'm at UCLA. My question is, one of our accomplishments as graduate students is that we produced a thing called a dissertation, right? And we acquired a bunch of skills from writing a dissertation. How do we talk about it in a LinkedIn profile without being a turnoff?
Right.
Do we call it a research project? What do we call it?
So I think it's perfectly okay in the education section to actually write the dissertation and the title. You might even want to have just a brief summary if there was particular research methodology that you engaged in. So quantitative, qualitative, some type of analysis. You can choose as to whether you want to actually include that as another item under your experience section and call it like a project. So it really just depends on how you're doing it. When you do that, you just want to be very explicit that it was part of this project, which is ultimately your dissertation. But you can certainly have it in two different sections of education and experience. And you'll want to treat it like you would any other type of experience with the accomplishments that you had, the actions you took, if there were results, what that looked like, who was the audience that benefited, et cetera. So I would say utilize it in multiple spaces if you can.
Hi, I'm Christina Markman from UCLA History Department. Thank you very much, this is very interesting. I have a LinkedIn profile, but I know what I'm gonna do right now.
Great.
My question is, if you're a career switcher,
yes,
and let's say you're connected with your current boss, mm-hmm, and you're getting ready to switch careers, and you write in your profile that you are seeking new opportunities in this or that field.
Yes.
Is that dangerous for your current career?
So what I would say is it's all about rhetoric, right? So I would actually couch it as, seeking potential collaborations or new opportunities. And I think people essentially know what that means. Part of that also includes you talking about it from a perspective of a potential research area or a potential interest area, as opposed to being very explicit and saying, I'm looking for a job in X. You can certainly say, I'm looking for opportunities and collaborative exchanges in this particular field. That actually leaves it a little bit open for you. And even if your current boss is there, it's pretty much expected that you would keep abreast with your particular industry or function. So I would say utilizing rhetoric to also help you share what you're interested in is a nice way to couch it. But essentially, with LinkedIn, people are always looking. And I think there's that expectation that you are open to options as well. Does that help? Okay, great.
Hi. Hi, I'm Claire. I'm at UCLA in the philosophy department. And I was just curious, this is really kind of a follow-up question, if you have any advice for the ask in your professional summary surrounding if you're still in your PhD program, if you're not even ABD, if you're not even sure that you'd particularly like to continue with your program, just in terms of being a little bit strategic with who you're connected to and, you know, it's publicly available and all that.
So I think it's a very similar theme in terms of really talking about the interest as opposed to the actual opportunity. So I would just talk about it in terms of what are the areas that you want to explore. So let's say you are interested in some particular topics that might be very relevant for you. I would position it as you wanting to make connections with people with similar interest in X. And then I think just by the very nature of expressing that you're looking for that, you will start seeing individuals who are part of that community who have various career paths that are related to that. The other way to also to address that is to go on the group site. So I would suggest that you join certain groups that are diverse. And I think the way that you can approach the groups is people won't have a sense for the fact that you're looking to switch because you can have interdisciplinary interests. And that is a way to really address it. Like, you have interdisciplinary interests that you want to explore. Hence, you are looking for research collaborators, people with similar interests, who can actually, you know, connect with you. And I think in terms of, you know, do you actually say I'm looking for another program or another job? You can just leave it as I'm looking for opportunities that deal with these particular issues or this particular field. And then that's where you will reach out to people either using InMail or leveraging the relationships with people who you have connections with that can introduce you to those other people.
Hello, Anne. I'm Lisa from UCLA. So I'm currently lecturing at multiple universities or multiple institutions. And so my job listing on LinkedIn is chronological, and I'm looking to switch. Mm-hmm. And I'm wondering, I've been doing some things that are outside of my actual job description, and doing kind of one-offs and organizing conferences and doing other things. How might I be able to highlight those other projects that I'm doing and actually maybe put them up higher somehow than my actual, you know, kind of 9-to-5?
Sure.
So that to highlight those because they seem to be closer to what I want to do.
Yes. So I think that is really where you can leverage the experience section. It doesn't necessarily have to say it's work experience. So I would treat some of your conference work and some of your other projects as projects. And think about it from the perspective of you being a consultant working on a project. So I would essentially list that as a project and talk about the key accomplishments and the functions that you serve in that particular role. What you can do is you can certainly look at your list of experiences and see which ones may or may not be relevant. The thing is, you have to be careful about removing certain things because it'll show as gaps on your LinkedIn. You don't want to have this ginormous gap if you had, say, a particular position for a while. But maybe you still list it, but you don't have a very long description of the functions that you serve. So let's say you had a particular role. Maybe you might have one or two bullets on that that's not as relevant to your target. But then for some of these other projects or conference-related pieces that you do want to highlight, you add a little bit more description to it. So I think that's one way to approach it as well. And then the other thing to consider is thinking about themes. So when you are writing your LinkedIn profile, if there are particular themes or skill sets that you want to really emphasize, make sure that that comes through in your descriptions in your experience section. So whether you want to say that you have particular skills or you are familiar with certain things, just make sure it is a path and a theme that keeps recurring, because that will hint to the reader that that's something that is of interest to you as well. And I think that's a subtle way of saying, I'm doing this over and over, and this is also either what I want to do or I want to utilize that skill.
Hi, I'm Raylan from UCR, and over the past 10 years, I've accumulated really good experience in three different but related areas. And so when I'm, you know, going through my LinkedIn profile, I have to kind of pick and choose what to do. How far back should you go? Like, my teaching experience is obviously moving up and up, and so your experience becomes not better experience, but maybe higher experience.
Yes.
Or in editing, you know, you have different ones. How do you show that you have a long history without listing all of those things? Because your experience starts to come out and then you never get to the rest, right?
Exactly.
You don't get to the honors or the publications or anything.
Right. So I think that's a really relevant question. And I think with LinkedIn, because it is an electronic medium, people expect to see the most recent information. So the way I would approach it is I would definitely highlight those pieces either under your experience or your education and add a little bit more content to that piece. In terms of your earlier experience, typically people tend to look in spheres of 5 to 10 years online. You don't necessarily want to drop off stuff before, say, 10 years, but maybe you add less to it. So you're still going to include those particular positions and organizations that you work with, but maybe the description is just a one-liner as opposed to your more recent experiences where you can delve into the nuances of what you're doing. And I think people totally expect that too, because as you tend to progress in your career, you're going to have more meaningful and more insightful things to share. And that will guide what you're looking to do in your next career decision. Yeah.
Okay, so let us thank Dr. Ann Dela Cruz once again for this very wonderful and informative talk.